Can children have true encounters with God? And if so, what does that look like and how does it happen? My name is Becky Fischer and I was a children's pastor for 10 years. But in the last 20 plus years, I've led an organization called Kids in Ministry International, or KIMI for short. Through KIMI, we have trained leaders in over 34 countries in our School of Supernatural Children's Ministry in just the last year. Collectively, we're reaching nearly 50,000 children with the supernatural gospel every week. We teach boys and girls and teenagers not just the basics of the Christian faith, but that they can walk in signs, wonders, and miracles just like Jesus taught us we could. Now, these are significant encounters with God, but there's a strategy to accomplishing that. It doesn't happen by accident. The first hurdle is convincing parents and church leaders that kids can not only do these things, but that the Bible also affirms it. For instance, Psalm 71:17 says, "Oh my God, you have taught me from my earliest childhood, and I constantly tell others about the wonderful things that you do." Heidi Baker, the famous missionary to Mozambique, says, "The greatest hindrance to children walking in the supernatural power of God is the doubt and unbelief of the adults around them." Someone else has said that children automatically believe in the supernatural until we tell them it doesn't exist. So is it really true that kids can have significant encounters with God? The simple answer is yes. Kids can encounter God in every way that adults can. Now keep in mind that a supernatural encounter is not always spectacular, but it is significant. Through the years, we've gathered dozens, maybe hundreds of testimonies, both big and small, of kids hearing God's voice, being led by the Spirit, healing the sick, operating in the gifts of the Spirit, and even casting out devils and raising the dead. Yeah, stuff you normally only associate with adult Christians. I tell dozens of those stories in my videos and books, so check them out on my website at kidsinministry.org and on my YouTube channel. If these things are of interest to you, please subscribe to my channel and click the notification bell below so every time I upload a new video, you're going to be notified. Now, in our ministry, we believe that everything Jesus said we as adult Christians could do in His name also applies to children. For instance, the last words He spoke to His disciples before He went back to heaven in Mark 16 was, "And these signs will accompany those who believe. In my name, they'll drive out demons. They'll speak with new tongues. They'll pick up snakes with their hands. And when they drink any deadly poison, it will not hurt them at all. They will place their hands on sick people, and those sick people will get well." Notice that nowhere in this scripture did He specify how old you had to be to do these things. He said, you just have to believe. So, if a four-year-old child has sincerely asked Jesus into his heart, he is a believer. That means he or she qualifies to do everything Jesus said believers can do. This includes getting born again, being filled with the Holy Spirit, hearing God's voice, being led by His Spirit, healing the sick and operating in the gifts of the Spirit, and more. Jesus told us, "I tell you the truth, anyone who believes in me will do the same works I have done and even greater works because I'm going to be with the Father." At John 14:12 says, "Anyone who believes in me." Anyone includes children. By walking in the supernatural power of God, children come to know that God, Jesus, and the Holy Spirit are real and not just interesting stories. But too often, we disqualify children in our minds and we assume they're too young to understand the deep truths of God's Word. The numbers have been growing in recent years, but unfortunately, there are still very few children's ministries that actually teach and train children to believe for and walk in the power of God. That includes Christian parents who frequently never even consider that it's an option. I go into that in great detail in my book called A Parent's Guide to Raising Spiritual Champions, where I encourage parents to disciple their children at home in these things, and I share why and how to do it. If you're interested in getting a copy for yourself or for a parent that you know, I have a link to it in the description below. Then let me know in the comments if this is a book that interests you and why. Do you think it would be helpful for you? But before we continue, you need to know some very important things about what is and what is not happening in our churches regarding children and youth, because it greatly affects whether or not our kids can have encounters with God. I share this to stress how important it is for parents to take a greater role and responsibility in the training of their children at home, no matter what type of church you attend. Traditional evangelical, denominational, Pentecostal, prophetic, home church, etc., most Christian parents believe that the church is better equipped to take care of the spiritual education and discipleship of their children than they are. But the big unspoken secret in the body of Christ is that both children's and youth ministry in our churches today is broken. Even though it looks bright and shiny and robust, and it looks like we have it all together, the truth is very few children's or youth ministries are producing children or teens who become lifelong devoted followers of Jesus Christ. In fact, depending on the source that you study, we know that anywhere from 60 to 70% of the children that we raise in our churches leave the church in their teen or college age years and they never return. Now, that's not all the fault of the churches. They can only do so much in 1 hour a week with our children. A lot of it is because Christian parents have almost completely delegated their spiritual responsibility to the church, and they think taking their kids to church occasionally is enough to do the job to make them into devoted Christians. Many parents feel inadequate at discipling their children, and they think the church can do it better. But still, regardless of that, they've yielded over their God-given responsibility of this to the church. And when the church was only meant to be a support system to what parents are biblically required to do at home. Now, what's really disturbing is that in the surveys, when Christian parents are asked what their top priorities are for their children, they will list things like happiness, health, good finances, education, good relationships, etc. But the importance of faith, growth, and development is almost never on their list. Go figure. There's many reasons young people might leave the church, because people and families are varied and they're very complex. But in our experience, in over 30 years of children's ministry, one of the significant reasons we've found is that most of our children see Jesus as the hero in stories, but not someone they really have a relationship with. Most 13-year-olds who've been raised in our Sunday schools will tell us in surveys that, to their knowledge, they've never heard God's voice nor felt His presence. In other words, they have never had an encounter with God in their churches. Ever. All they have is head knowledge of God and Jesus, but no heart knowledge. In too many cases, we've given them religion with no relationship. If the parents are not working with them at home, they can go to church their entire lives and never have a significant experience with the Holy Spirit. Because most Christian parents are satisfied with what they're receiving in the adult services, they just assume it's just as spiritually rich in the children's services. But they never really investigate very deeply to see what's going on in there. In fact, most parents will frequently ask their children if they had fun in church that day, and if the child says yes, then the parents are lulled into thinking that they had a meaningful spiritual experience. But having fun in children's church or Sunday school does not equal having an encounter with the Holy Spirit. What are their children really learning about God and the Bible beyond the Bible stories? Really, if we're honest, many churches are only giving them a watered-down gospel. A shocking statistic that you need to know about is that only about 12% of children's pastors and youth pastors have a biblical worldview. That means they do not necessarily believe the Bible is infallible, inerrant word of God, or that we can trust and rely on it for our decisions fully and directions for our lives. Their worldviews are a mixture of everything they read, hear on TV, are exposed to on social media, and the crazy junk they're being taught in our educational systems from kindergarten through university. It's called synchronism, which is the practice of combining different, often opposing beliefs and various schools of thought along with parts of the Bible. In essence, they're making up their own religion. So it really makes you wonder exactly what are those leaders teaching our children and teens in our churches. That's one big reason why parents need to be proactive at home to teach their children about biblical and spiritual truths. Don't worry, it's a lot easier than you think. In addition, most children's pastors, regardless of denomination, are basically all taught from the same pool of ideas in training events, conferences, books, curriculums, and other things that every other kid's minister is trained from. That's because publishers, conference leaders, curriculum writers, etc., are trying to reach as many leaders across many denominational lines as possible. They have a business to run, and they need lots of customers. So they stay away from anything considered controversial, such as water baptism. Do we dunk or do we sprinkle? The baptism of the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues, the supernatural works of the believer, even things you would think most of us would agree on, like hearing God's voice, or even discussions about the presence of God and the anointing of the Holy Spirit are never mentioned. Even many Pentecostal and charismatic churches avoid those topics in children's and youth ministries. So if those things are important to you as a parent, just realize that your child may or may not learn about them in the church that you go to, even if the adults are being taught about them in the adult services. Now, all of this impacts whether children ever have an encounter with God of any kind. So what's the answer? After 30 years of being a part of the kids' ministry culture, I've discovered there are three critical elements that are missing in most children's and youth ministries. I wrap them up in what we call our three core values. I'm mentioning them in this teaching because if we don't understand these three things, then everything else I have to say about your children having encounters with God will pretty much be irrelevant. Core value number one, meet. Our kids are lacking the meat of God's word in most of our ministries today. In most of our churches, we just keep repeating the same Bible stories over and over again. We never ground them in the full counsel of God. I've said so many times, kids cannot live by Bible stories alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Core value number two, equipping. For the most part, there's no equipping or training to walk in the things Jesus said every believer would walk in, which in short is the supernatural lifestyle of Christ, or the ways we encounter God. They can attend the church their entire lives and never be filled with the Holy Spirit, never learn to hear God's voice, never learn to do the things said His followers would do. Core value number three, presence. In the vast majority of children's ministries, the presence of God is not evident at all, or is only obvious in very limited ways. In many cases, we have become professional entertainers, learning how to hold their attention and accommodate their shortest attention spans. But this means our children may possibly never have any significant encounter with the Holy Spirit in their services. They may never feel His presence. They may never experience His power or the anointing of the Holy Spirit. To them, He remains a theory, not a reality. Does this make sense to you? Are these three core values a notable part of your child's church experience? Yes or no? Tell me what you notice and in the comments below. Now, I've watched repeatedly that when we train children's ministers how to embrace our three core values and we show them how to apply them in their services, their children grow and thrive in their walk with the Lord in phenomenal ways. They become excited about God instead of disinterested, and the Lord becomes meaningful and relevant to them. They look forward to going to church instead of dreading it. Too often, over the decades, we as Christian parents and church leaders have only seen children after the flesh and not after the Spirit. Therefore, we conclude they're not capable of actually becoming serious disciples of Christ until they're at least teenagers, and maybe even older. We have just decided that from toddlerhood till they reach their teen years, their ministries are more or less placeholders for them until they grow up enough to become valuable members in the kingdom of God. When the truth is, they are desperately hungry to know who God really is, and they want to partner with Him in what He's doing on the earth today. Whatever you are hungry for spiritually is what they are hungry for spiritually. The difference is they don't know how to tell you that or how to express it. But when we give them an opportunity to encounter His presence and operate in spiritual things, they come alive. Now, this is part one of a series on the topic of Can Children Encounter God? Please look for part two by the same title very soon. Thanks for watching. Now, share this teaching with your friends, especially parents, and don't forget to subscribe to my channel. Until next time, let's keep reaching the next generation for Jesus. Thanks for watching.